Hello guys, what's up? How are you all? Today we will discuss all the relevant news and the current affairs of the day. And let's start with a famous quote. And our famous quote is derived from quotes of Vivekananda. And according to this quote, there is no other spiritual teacher than your own soul. That is your own soul, your own path. And if you follow your own soul, then this is the right path, and you will be your own teacher. And if you want to in a development for your spiritual development, then there is no need to any other spiritual teacher. And your own soul is your spiritual teacher, and it is the quote of Swami Vivekananda. Let's discuss all the relevant current affairs of the day, which is relevant for UPSC mains and also for prelims. And we continued from last 1 month, but due to some problems it was discontinued, and there is a lot of problems, so I faced, and now there are no any problems, and we will discuss all the current affairs and the relevant news from today continuously, and there will be no problem of discontinued. And let's start from today, and have a great journey of us. Then first start. This current affairs is taken from Insight's daily current affairs, so you can directly go through the web page of Insight, and let's discuss what is today's main news. Let's discuss about the context. That is, the Prime Minister Narendra Modi to confer National Youth Parliament Festival 2019 awards to the winners. In previous month, National Youth Parliament with the collaboration of National Service Scheme and Nehru Institution, Nehru Yuva Kendra Sangathan, that is NYKS, and it's about that then discuss that the Prime Minister Narendra Modi to confer the National Youth Parliament Festival 2019 award to the winners. And what is its background? National Youth Parliament Festival 2019 was celebrated on 12th January 2019 on the occasion of National Youth Day. That is, the National Youth Parliament Festival 2019 theme was Be the Voice of New India. Let's discuss that is the National Youth Parliament Festival 2019 was celebrated on 12th January on the occasion of National Youth Day, and that is the theme for National Youth Parliament of 2019, and the theme is the Be the Voice of New India and Find Solutions and Contribute to Policy. What is the eligibility criteria for National Youth Parliament? That is, the candidates should be students between the age of 18 to 25, and those students are invited to participate in the district youth parliaments. Discuss what is its significance. The National Youth Parliament Festival will encourage the youth to engage public issues, understand the common man's point of view from their opinion, and express these in the articulate manner. Relevant and effective voices on the vision of New India would be captured and documented to make this available to policymakers and implementers to take it forward. And it was jointly organized by National Service Scheme, that is NSS, and Nehru Yuva Kendra Sangathan, and under the aegis of Ministry of Youth Affairs and Sports. It was under Youth Affairs and Sports. Ministry of Youth Affairs and Sports. Let's discuss about National Youth Day. The National Youth Day, it was also called Yuva Divas, is observed on January 12 every year to commemorate the birthday of Swami Vivekananda. And the main objective is to propagate the philosophy and the ideas of Swami Vivekananda. And it became a mainstream celebration in India from 1985 onwards and observed on January 12 ever since. Let's discuss some key points about the National Service Scheme, that is NSS. The National Service Scheme is an Indian government-based sponsored public service program conducted by Ministry of Youth Affairs and Sports of the Government of India. The scheme was launched in Gandhiji's centenary year 1969, that is, it was launched in the Gandhiji's centenary year in 1969. And the University Grants Commission, that is UGC, UGC headed by Dr. Radhakrishnan, recommended introduction of national service in the academic institutions on a voluntary basis with a view to develop healthy contacts between the students and the teachers on the one hand and establishing constructive linkage between the campus and community in the other hand. That is, its main aim is to it is a linkage between the campus and a community in the other hand. And it is a voluntary basis with a view on developing healthy contacts between the students and teachers on the one hand and establishing a constructive linkage between the campus and the community on the other hand. Let's discuss what is about Nehru Yuva Kendra Sangathan, that is NYKS. Nehru Yuva Kendra was established in 1972, later in 1987 under Rajiv Gandhi government, it became Nehru Yuva Kendra Sangathan, and it is an autonomous organization under Ministry of Youth Affairs and Sports. It also comes under Ministry of Youth Affairs and Sports. Then comes to next context, and the next context is about the Skill Sathi Youth Conclave. Then discuss what is this and let's see its context, and the context is that the New Odisha Dharmapada Sambad Skill Sathi Youth Conclave was recently held in Bhubaneswar, Odisha. That is, it was held recently in Bhubaneswar, Odisha, and it is about the Nua Odisha Dharmapada Sambad Skill Skill Sathi Youth Conclave. The Skill Sathi initiative has so far mobilized and counseled over 1 lakh candidates in Odisha and over 10 lakh youth across the country in the past 3 months. That is, the ETH initiative has to for mobilized and counseled over 1 lakh candidate, and its candidate is of 1 lakh and 10 lakh youth across the country in the past 3 months. Then discuss what is Skill Sathi Scheme. The Skills Career Counsel scheme aims to counsel 1 crore candidates from the age group of 15 to 35 years, focusing on school and college dropouts, young adults from the community, college students, polytechnic students, IT students, diploma students, graduate, postgraduate, NEET category, NEET category TC, PAN India from August 2018. And the council will be conducted on a standardized module or contact as defined by the NSDC and MSDE. Then discuss objectives of the Skill Sathi Scheme. There are some key points about its objective, that is, create awareness about the Skill India mission and inform the youth of India about vocational education and its opportunities. That is, it will awareness about the Skill India mission and inform the youth of the India about vocational education. That is, it deals with vocational education and how to create awareness about vocational education. Then next point is that the sensitized prospective candidates about available market opportunity under the Skill India mission. In Skill India mission, there will be many market opportunities will be arise, and how to sensitize prospective candidates about available market opportunities under the Skill India mission, and facilitates psychometric testing and face-to-face counseling interventions to create an individual level impact to guide aspirants to make the right choice of training and subsequent employment entrepreneurship. Facilitate understanding of the concepts of New India, the prospects of India becoming the skill capital of the world, and how the new generation of youth can become drivers of the change. That is the how the youth generation can become drivers of the change. That is the changes should be made by the youth, and it's about that. Then comes to next context. And the next context is related to Pradhan Mantri Abbas Yojana. And it is the Pradhan Mantri Abbas Yojana Urban. That is PMAY Urban. That is, we'll discuss its key features and significance of the scheme, challenges ahead, and measures needed to achieve the target. Then discuss the context. The Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs has approved the construction of another of 560,695 more affordable houses for the benefit of urban poor under Pradhan Mantri Abbas Yojana. That is the Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs, that is MHUA, has approved the construction of another 560,695 more affordable houses for the benefit of urban poor under Pradhan Mantri Abbas Yojana. Then discuss its challenges. The scheme faces headwinds such as unavailability of land in prime areas, low participation of private developers on account of brand dilution, binding mechanism, stringent cost and time schedules resulting in low yields, increasing construction cost due to absence of a bulk sourcing of materials and lack of new technology that impacts productivity, cost efficiency and quality. That is, there are some challenges and the scheme faces headwinds such as unavailability of land prime areas. There are some causes such as unavailability of land prime areas, low participation of private developers, that is, there are low participating from private companies on account of brand dilution, binding mechanism, stringent cost and time schedules resulting in low yields. And it's age of a stringent cost and it's a time schedule resulting in low yields and increasing construction cost is also one of the major causes. And it's also absence of bulk sourcing of materials and lack of new technology that impacts productivity, cost efficiency and quality. Then discuss what is the significance of this scheme. That is, Pradhan Mantri Abbas Yojana Urban does offer a huge opportunity for several sectors by setting up a virtuous cycle. That is, it is a huge opportunity for several sectors. That is, several sectors can engage themselves for the development of the Pradhan Mantri Abbas Yojana and also can be boost their own economy, as well as it also provide employment to the public. One crore houses would mean an opportunity for over 2 lakh crore of home loans and incremental consumption of 100 million ton of cement and 10 to 15 million of ton of steel. And the construction opportunity is of about 4 billion square feet over the life of Pradhan Mantri Abbas Yojana Urban, and all that would translate into 9 to 10 crore incremental jobs over the execution period. That is the main point. That is, the construction opportunity is of about 4 billion square feet, and that is the construction of opportunity is about 4 billion square feet over the Pradhan Mantri Abbas Yojana Urban, and all that would translate into 9 to 10 crore incremental jobs over the execution period. Then what about Pradhan Mantri Abbas Yojana Urban? Then discuss what is Pradhan Mantri Abbas Yojana. That is, the Pradhan Mantri Abbas Yojana Urban program launched by the Ministry of Housing and Urban Poverty Alleviation in mission mode evictions provision of housing for all by 2022 and when the nation completes 75 years of its independence. It's targeting the 75 years of independence of 1922. That is the Pradhan Mantri Abbas Yojana program launched the Ministry of Housing and Urban Poverty Alleviation in mission mode envisions provision of housing and it will be completed in 2022 targeting its mission. The mission seeks to address the housing requirement of urban poor including slum dwellers through following program of verticals and the slum rehabilitation of slum dwellers with the participation of private developers using land as a resource. That is the land is the main resource for the slum dwellers and who is living there and it is a rehabilitation of initiative for this slum areas and the slum it is concerned under slum rehabilitation of slum dwellers with the participation of private developers using land as a resource and the mission seeks address of the promotion of affordable housing for weaker section through credit linked subsidy affordable housing in partnership with the public and private sectors and a subsidy for beneficiary led individual house construction enhancement. Then let's discuss some key facts about this. That is the beneficiaries are poor and people living under EWS and LIG categories in the country. That is the scheme is divided into three phases. In the first phase, a total of 100 cities will be covered from April 2015 to March 2017. Let's once again discuss about the key facts. That is the beneficiaries are the beneficiaries who belong to this scheme is are poor and people living under AWS economically weaker sections and LIG categories in the countries and this scheme is divided into three phases and let's discuss what is those phases. In the first phase, a total of 100 cities will be covered from April 2015 to March 2017. In first phase, a total of 100 cities will be covered from April 2015 to 2017. And in phase 2, 200 cities will be covered from April 2017 to March 2019. And in the third phase, the leftover cities will be covered from April 2019 to March 2020. It's over of three pages and in first pages which will cover from April 2015 to March 2017 and there are 100 cities included. In second pages 200 cities will be covered from April 2017 to March 2019 and in the third pages the leftover cities will be covered from April 2019 to March 2022. The government is providing an interest subsidy of 6.5% on housing loans which can be availed by the beneficiaries for 15 years from start of the loan date. The government will grant rupees 1 lakh to all the beneficiaries of the scheme. In addition, rupees 1.5 lakh will be given to all eligible urban poor who want to construct their houses in urban areas or plan to go for renovation in their existing houses. One can also avail loans under this scheme to build toilets in existing houses. The government will also grant rupees 1 lakh to all the beneficiaries of the scheme. That is, the all the beneficiaries will be granted 1 lakh of rupees and in addition with rupees 1.5 lakh will be given to all eligible urban poor who want to construct their houses in urban areas or plan to go for renovation in their existing houses. Then let's discuss what is the next context. That is the next context is about the global digital health partnership. That discusses its context. That is the India is housing fourth summit of global digital health partnership. That is India is going to hosting
4th Summit of Global Digital Health Partnership. Then discuss what is Global Digital Health Partnership. Global Digital Health Partnership, that is GDSP, is an international collaboration of governments, government agencies and multinational organizations dedicated to improving the health and well-being of their citizens through the best use of evidence-based digital technologies. That is, it is an international collaboration of governments, government agencies and multinational organizations dedicated to improving the health and well-being of their citizens through the best use of evidence-based digital technologies. It was established in February 2018, that is one year ago, and the Global Digital Health Partnership provides an opportunity for the transformational engagement between its participants who are striving to learn and share best practice and policy that can support their digital health systems. It has been created to provide an international platform to facilitate global collaboration and cooperation to share policy insights, best practices, and evidence-based implementation of a safe, secure digital technology to improve the quality, accessibility, and sustainability of health systems. Then discuss what is GDHP, that is the Global Digital Health Partnership member countries. There are currently 23 countries. That is, now there are 23 countries and are the member of this group, which include Argentina, Australia, Austria, Brazil, Canada, Estonia, Hong Kong, India, Japan, Republic of Indonesia, Italy, New Zealand, Netherlands, Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, Singapore, South Korea, Switzerland, Sweden, Portugal, the United Kingdom and United States, Ukraine, Uruguay and the World Health Organization. And there are 23 countries and all the countries we discussed. And there are a point that the 5 work streams of Global Digital Health Partnership. That is, what is the work streams? There are 5 work streams. And the first one is cyber security. First one is cyber security, evidence and evaluation, policy environments, interoperability, clinical and consumer engagement. Those are the five streams, such as cyber security, evidence and evaluation, policy environments, and interoperability, clinical and consumer engagement. Then the point is that why is the Global Digital Health Partnership important for populations globally? What is its important? As countries around the world face the challenges of designing systems and delivering services that result in good health and well-being for their citizens, digital technologies can provide potential solutions. They can improve the safety, quality of, and effectiveness of healthcare, support earlier diagnosis of disease and the development of new medicines and treatments. They can empower patients, citizens, and the care professionals who serve them. Governments are making significant investments to harness the power of technology and foster innovation and public-private partnerships that support high-quality, sustainable health and care for all. The Global Digital Health Partnership facilitates global collaboration and cooperation in the implementation of digital health services. There is currently no similar international forum to share the best practice and enable co-working in digital health. That is the main important point. And Then comes to next context. That is, the next context is related to iPrism. Then discuss what is iPrism, and it is a IP related issue, and then discuss what is the context. We will clear what is iPrism after reading the context. the sale of IPR promotion and management, that is CIPAM, that is CPM, a department for promotion of industry and international trade in collaboration with ASEAN and ASEAN. India has launched the second edition of IPRGM, an intellectual property competition for students of school, polytechnic institutions and colleges and universities. The sale for IPR promotion and management department of promotion of industry and international trade in collaboration with ASEANCHAM and ERICCSSON India has launched the second edition of IPRGM, and it is an intellectual property competition for students of our school, polytechnic institutions, colleges and university. That is, it's overall it is intellectual property competition, that is IP competition, and this sale for IPR promotion and management, and it comes under IPR promotion and management and department for promotion of industry and internal trade in collaboration with ASEAN and Ericsson. India has launched the second edition of IPRGM, and it is the second edition, and we discussed that that is basically it is an intellectual property competition for students, school college students, and aiming to foster a culture of innovation and creativity in the younger generation. The competition will provide young creators an opportunity to see their creations recognized on a national platform. That is, it provide young it is providing young creators an opportunity to see their creations recognized in a national platform. Then discuss about CIPAM, and CIPAM stands for Sale for IPR Promotion and Management. That is, CIPAM has been created as a professional body under the aegis of DIPP to take forward the implementation of the national IPR policy that was approved by the government in May 2016 with the slogan Creative India, Innovative India. And its slogan is Creative India and Innovative India. Then discuss what is its function. The functions of a CIPAM is working towards creating public awareness about IPRs in the country and promoting the filing of IPRs through facilitation, providing inventors with a platform to commercialize their IP assets, and coordinating the implementation of national IPR policy in collaboration with the government, ministers and the department and other stakeholders. It's a collaboration with other government ministry and departments, and it is working towards creating public awareness about key points, such as it's a creating public awareness about IPR in the country and promoting the filing of IPR through facilitation, providing inventors with a platform to commercialize their IP assets, and coordinating the implementation of the national IPR policy in we discussed it here. And let's discuss some relevant articles from various newspapers, and first is the about the prepaid payment instruments. And let's discuss its context. In a much needed respite to e-wallet companies, the Reserve Bank of India has extended deadline for completion of Know Your Customer, that is KYC norms for prepaid payments instrument issuers by 6 months. It's about e-wallet companies, and in a much needed respite to e-wallet companies, the Reserve Bank of India has extended deadline for completion to Know Your Customer norms for prepaid payment instrument issuers by 6 months. And let's discuss what is its background. As per RBI directors, PPI issuers, and the PPI stands for prepaid payment instrument issuers, were required to complete the KYC process by February 28, 2019, and the PPI that is the prepared payment instruments instrument issuers are issuers or mobile wallets were mandated by the banking regulator in October 2017 to capture all information required under the Know Your Customer guidelines by end of February. Then what is a prepaid payment instrument? Prepaid payment instruments are those which facilitate purchase of goods and services against the value stored in such instruments. That is, the prepaid payment instruments are those which facilitate purchase goods and services against the value stored on such instruments, and value stored on them is paid by the holder using a medium, and such mediums are cash, debit card, credit card, etc. Prepaid payment instruments are those which let's once again discuss what is prepaid payment instruments. And the prepaid payment instruments are those which facilitate purchase of goods and services against the value stored on such instruments. This is the key point, that is the prepaid payment instruments are those which facilitate purchase of goods and services against the value stored in such accounts. Let's discuss about Paytm. We connect Paytm with our bank account, and it's much easier if it is of a Paytm payment bank. Then the Paytm is providing services and buying goods, etc. Such as payment of electricity, water bill, etc. We provided our value such as our bank account and our deposits. Then it's about that, and these are generally issued in the forms of smart cards, mobile wallets, paper vouchers, internet accounts, and wallets. Prepaid payment instruments come with a prepaid loaded value, and in some cases a predefined purpose of payment. They facilitate the purchase of goods and services, as well as interpersonal remittance transactions such as sending money to a friend or a family member. And these payment instruments are licensed and regulated by the Reserve Bank of India. And there are three types of PPIs, that is closed system prepaid payment instrument, and semi-closed system prepaid payment instrument, and open system prepaid payment instrument. The most common example of closed system prepaid payment instrument is a brand specific gift card, such as cards, physical or otherwise, can be used only at specific locations and cannot be used to transfer funds from one account to another. And it's a source from Hindu. Then discuss what is the next, and the next context is that the about the dispute between Britain and Mauritius over Chagos Islands, and it's about a dispute about Mauritius and Chagos Islands. And then discuss what is its dispute, and first then it's then discuss the context. The UK should end its control of Chagos Islands in the Indian Ocean as rapidly as possible. The United Nations highest court has said, the International Court of Justice said, the islands were not lawfully separated from the former colony of Mauritius. That is, according to United Nations highest court, he said that it is a former colony of Mauritius, and the Britain and the UK should end its control of the Chagos Islands in the Indian Ocean as rapidly as possible. Then it is a statement of a UK Foreign Office that this is an advisory opinion, not a judgment. That is, UK is not obeying this decision, and it's a map about that. Let's look where is Mauritius situated. The Mauritius is situated in the east of Madagascar island of Africa continent in the Indian Ocean, and it's so far as this location is Chagos Island, and Mauritius is situated here. So it's a long distance from, but let's look at the its where is the it's situated in Africa. Then discuss what is issue. Britain detached the Chagos Islands from Mauritius in 1965, 3 years before Mauritian independence. From 1967 to 1973, some 1500 Chagos Islanders were gradually forced to leave their homes so that the largest island, Diego Garcia, could be released to the US for a strategic air base. Today, Diego Garcia hosts a major US military base. It is the main issue we should understand that is the Britain detached the Chagos Islands from Mauritius in 1965. That is, it was detached from Mauritius from 1961 by the Britain, and it was after the three years of Mauritian independence. That is in the year of 1962. From 1967 to 73, some 1500 Chagos Islanders were gradually forced to leave their homes so that the largest island, Diego Garcia, could be leased to the US for a strategic air base. And now the Diego Garcia hosts a major US military base that is from 1967 to 1973. In the 6 years, some 1,500 Chagos Islanders were gradually forced to leave their homes so that the largest island, Diego Garcia, could be leased to the US for a strategic air base. In 2016, after several judicial challenges, Britain extended Diego Garcia's lease until 2036 and declared that the expelled islanders would not be allowed to go back. And that is the who expelled from these islands, so they are not allowed to go back to Diego Garcia Island. And in 2017, Mauritius successfully petitioned the United Nations to seek an International Court of Justice advisory opinion on the legality of this separation. And Mauritius claims it was forced to give up the islands, now a British overseas territory, in 1965 in exchange for independence, which is gained in 1968. That is, it was Mauritius claim it was forced to give up the islands, and that is Mauritius claimed to give up the island by the British, and now a British overseas territory, and it is now a British overseas territory, not the territory present territory of British. And in 1965, in exchange of independence, it was gained by Mauritius in 1968. Then discuss then discuss what is the next context. As the next context is the 9 new items added to MSP for minor forest produce scheme. That is, the MSP stands for minimum support price, and the context is that the Ministry of Tribal Affairs has added 9 minor forest produce items to its minimum support price for MSP scheme. The total number of MFPs covered under the list is 49. And then discuss what is those 9 new items are bakul, that is dried bark, kutals, dried bark, nonial dried fruits, that is sonapatha or sonak pods, chanothi seeds, kalihari, that is dried tubers, makoid, that is dried fruits, apang plant, and sugandh natri roots, and those nine items are added, then discuss what is about the next context. And the next context is about the NASA few origins. That is the discuss that is NASA has captured the sharpest ever image of ultra the new image shows circular pieces of terrain, deeps and other details that were previously elusive. That is the NASA, that is stands for National Aeronautic Space Administration, has captured the sharpest ever image of ultra-thule, and that is new image shows circular pieces of terrain, deep fields and other details that are previously elusive. And it's a sharpest image of ultra-thule, and it was published by NASA, and the new images shows circular pieces of such places which is previously elusive, and it's showing circular pieces of the terrain, deep fields and other details. Detailed information, and then discuss next context. WFIRST telescope will give humans the largest, deepest, clearest picture of the universe since the Hubble Space Telescope could find as many as 1,400 new planets outside Earth's solar system. The new telescope paves the way for a more accurate, more focused search for extraterrestrial life, with about 100 of the not yet discovered planets having the same or lower mass as Earth. And WFIRST, that is WFIRST telescope, will give humans the more deepest, largest and clearest picture than the Hubble Space Telescope. It's about that. Then comes to next context. That is the end of the this, and thanks for watching. Let's we will meet tomorrow, and thanks a lot. Please subscribe my channel and motivate me for making videos, making everyday videos, and for and to make my voice clear so that you can understand better, and for my efficiency should be increased by every day with you all. And please motivate me, please share, comment, and please subscribe. Thanks a lot. Have a nice day.